It's not a matter of choosing between one of them. I think it's a matter of looking closely at what can work for us perfectly. You understand that they say peace, there can be no peace without justice, and there can be no justice without peace. Of course, somehow reconciliation has to do with peace, because when you reconcile people, then that automatically should bring peace. But also, if you remove justice from the equation, then that becomes a kind of a little problem. The interesting thing about today is that there are people who see issues of justice, reconciliation and peace as opposed to each other. But for us, I don't think there should be any opposition. I think justice, peace and reconciliation should actually be seen as things that should work together. And if you also listen to the former Secretary General Kofi Annan, he said specifically that justice, peace and reconciliation should go together. But the issue is which one should come first, and that actually has to do with policymakers. The International Criminal Court believes that you should pursue justice irrespective of the circumstances and situations. Some other people believe you can sequence peace before justice. The current Secretary General of the UN, Ban Ki-moon, also believed that these three teams should work together, and that the most important thing is to ensure that one does not hamper the other. I think it's a big challenge, and if you look in Africa today, this issue of justice, peace and reconciliation still affect development. But I guess the issue is not which one should be relegated to the back door. I think the issue should be how do we mainstream all of them to ensure that we have both justice, peace and reconciliation. The Nigerian situation is very peculiar, and for me, I believe that the government has taken steps. The government has declared a state of emergency in some of the regions where the fight is going on. The government has established, adopted a law, the Prevention of Terrorism Act. The government is also prosecuting some of the individuals who they believe should be held accountable. But this does not address some of the fundamental questions that is actually on in Nigeria. If you recall in my presentation yesterday, I spoke about what happened between the government and the insurgents from the Niger Delta, where the government offered amnesty to the insurgents, especially because it became a political issue. And we realized that government was losing a lot of money in terms of the oil revenue. So I guess the government of Yaradua decided to grant amnesty. And I think it worked to an extent. But the issue remains that the underlying factors that led to the Niger Delta insurgency has not yet been addressed. And we still know that there are grievances. But Boko Haram is another kettle of fish. It's a more fundamentalism that claims to anchor itself on Islam. Although, interestingly, the Organization of Islamic Conference has disclaimed Boko Haram and says it doesn't represent the Muslim community. And major Muslim leaders in Nigeria have also stated obviously that Boko Haram does not represent Muslim interests in Nigeria. So these are what you can call extremists, people who are allied to Al-Qaeda and who are trying to bring Nigeria to collapse. And you can compare them actually with the Lord's Resistance Army in northern Uganda that claimed that they wanted to overthrow the Museveni government and establish a rule based on the Ten Commandments of the Bible. Interestingly, there have also been accusations that the government forces have committed atrocities in trying to bring down the Boko Haram insurgency. The big challenge is that there is a growing distrust about government's own commitment to developing an enabling environment to stop this insurgency. elections are coming up in 2015. So some people also argue that some of the insurgencies and insecurities we are witnessing in Nigeria has something to do with the elections that is coming up in 2015. In the sense that some people have said that Jonathan should actually not contest for presidency. And the body movement shows that he may likely contest. So there is this tension between politicians, and there's argument that some politicians may actually be behind the insecurity we are witnessing in Nigeria today. So, although the International Criminal Court has established that the conflict currently going on in Nigeria is a non-international armed conflict, I think under the principle of complementarity, Nigeria still has a primary obligation and responsibility to hold her citizens accountable. And the Rome Statute clearly states that it is when Nigeria is unable and unwilling to hold her citizens accountable with the jurisdiction of the International Criminal Court be activated. So we still have a primary obligation as Nigerians to ensure that those who commit these crimes are held accountable. I think it's difficult to say this is what is going to happen next. I think the primary obligation the government has now is to ensure the rescue of the over 300 girls who were abducted by Boko Haram in Chibok. Now that presents a very big dilemma for the government. The Boko Haram insists that they are interested in a prison swap, in the sense that they are ready to release the girls if government releases some Boko Haram members who were arrested and are currently in detention. But you also know the security challenges that would pose if the government takes that route. Now, government set up a committee to advise the president on the possibility of granting amnesty to Boko Haram elements. But the information we're getting from the Boko Haram is that they are not interested in the amnesty. Even though you might say there might be a difference from the top echelon of Boko Haram membership and the foot soldiers. Because we are aware that there are some people who are already in detention who may be willing to accept the amnesty. So the question is this, where do we go from here? The insurgency may not be won through military conflict. That is very obvious. And it's not also, it doesn't seem likely that Boko Haram may overrun Nigeria in the next months or years. But the insecurity is causing a lot of hardship in Nigeria. And the citizens are beginning to wonder whether government has a commitment in protecting life and property. I think the election of 2015 is going to be decisive, in the sense that if Jonathan is allowed to contest, as a lot of people are in court to question his the possibility of the constitutionality of his contesting in 2015, even though it seems there is nothing that stops him constitutionally. So if we have a free and fair election, and the government has the possibility of reining in the insurgents, and they use the carrot stick approach, which means that even though government is saying we are ready for amnesty, they also ensure that the instrument of state is used to ensure that this insurgency is brought down to a considerable extent. I think we will begin to see the light at the end of the tunnel. But another issue that also has to be dealt is there is a lot of poverty in the north. And that is fueling a lot of mistrust, that is fueling a lot of some of these people who are being used by Boko Haram. And then there's the big question of the Nigerian military. There are so many reports that the military is not well equipped to confront the Boko Haram, who a lot of people now agree are using sophisticated weapons. So I guess government also needs to look closely at the funding that the military is getting and whether it is actually getting to the individuals who need them in order to fight Boko Haram. So it shouldn't be a situation where a lot of security vote is released, but at the end of the day, it doesn't get to the people that need the hardware. Oh, no.